So I'm just yet another developer like you. So there is nothing special about it. And so this is my third time BarCamp, so third time speaker as well. And yeah, a little warning. So this is my first non-programming presentations. So I have given a lot of other programming sessions. So I'm a little bit nervous, but excited. So this is about you. So this is going to be a pure introduction, introduction session. So if you know anything about cloud computing before, so there are a couple of advanced sessions out there. So you can go and check it out. So if you want to tweet about it, so that's the hashtags, you can use it. And so before we get started, we will talk about two companies, Instagram and Pinterest. So I hope we know these two companies. So both are started in late 2010, and Instagram sold to Facebook 1 year before for $1 billion. And the current valuation of Pinterest is $2.5 billion. So if you see that, within 1 or 2 years, so they went to a billion-dollar company. And you know how many developers they had? It's 2 and 3. And at the time of Instagram sold, they have only 13 employees. So if you look up at the company like Cognizant, so that's my first company, they took 12 years to reach 1 billion. And it took around 60,000 people to reach it. So with the use of cloud, you can have less people, so you can give everything to the cloud provider to manage all your data, so you can focus on your technology or your product or service. So 500px, so this is also following the same way. So if you see the similarity, all are photo sharing things. So there are a lot of storage requirements and there is a lot of computing requirements. Everything will be on the cloud. So this is a little bit story. And so why we need to use a cloud? So let's take about 3 use cases. Let's say the first one, and you already own a company and you have a new idea and you want to productize and you want to provide a service of it. And the profit or loss that should be reflected in the next quarter, so not in the next year quarter. So you want to implement and go to the market with very short time, so you need a cloud. And let's say the government or some other body is proposing a new kind of a technology or new kind of a standard, you need to quickly adopt it and you have to provide a solution out of it so that you can beat your competitions. And let's say the seasonal loads, let's say at the time of your tax submissions, Thanksgiving Day or Valentine's Day, it is going to be only very few days, so you need a large capacity of computing power it's required. So other time it will be ideal. So if you talk about the computing power, I think we all know about this Moore's law. So every 2 years, the hardware it will be doubled, the processing power. But so can we use those hardware still now? And there is a contradicting law. So it is coined by Google co-founder Larry Page, and it is echoed by Bill Gates also. So that is every 2 years, every 1.5 years, your software will be slow. So we all know, right? In 256 MB RAM, how much time Windows XP take to boot it? So we have some 4 GB or 8 GB now. So how much time Windows 7 takes it? So the software becomes slow. So you need more computing power to make it the faster. So there are a couple of requirements. I have a high volume of data and I need to process it faster. So if you see, these are all typically old kind of a requirement which is started from 1960 and 70. And at that time, we have only one option that is called mainframes, and only the big companies can able to adopt it, not every company like Pinterest or Instagram. And yeah, so let's go for what is cloud computing. So you can see there are a lot of buzzwords around it. People will talk about different definitions. So let's go for the basic Haiku's definition. Okay, it's a network of remote server. So it is managed by someone which is not visible to you. It's in the remote. And you wanted to access, right? If it is a remote, so you can able to access via internet, and you can use those servers to store and manage and process your data. And typically, yeah, so it is not going to be a local server. Everything is going to be in the remote. And if you see the data center, so I got a chance to see the data center last week. So this is a picture of the Google data center. You can see, so this is the cloud. You can see all the rack in the individual racks, so will have different segments. Everything will have a server. So it's not typically a CPU kind of things, it will have kind of things. And so this forms the cloud now. And what it provides is infinite supply of storage and your computational powers. And let's say how it operates. It operates on the paying us model. So what you can do is you can go and you can subscribe for your required infrastructure, and you can use their services and you can pay what you have used for. That's all. So it's very simple. And so this is a typical cloud computing diagram. So you have a storage to store your data, you have application to manage your data, and you have other infrastructure to process your data, and everything can be accessed via internet in other clients. And let's look at the evolution of the cloud computing. So if you see the virtualization, so it's a concept evolved in early 1980s to pool the hardware, so it will give you kind of a utility kind of the computing. So in the recent decade, so the virtualization is completely matured. And if you see the virtualized environment, it looks completely complex. We have seen the data structure, right? It will be much more complex. So they will have all the hypervisors, all the storage, all the networks, and all the servers. So they will make a virtualized environment out there. So this cloud symbol represents the abstraction of the complexity. It will hide all the complexity, and it will provide the abstraction view of for us. And so the virtualization enables compute cloud. So it will accumulate all the servers, and it will give you the large computational powers. This computational powers, it will process the data. So you need a storage. So that will require the storage clouds. And so both require the virtual network. Let's say we can have a one server which can able to run on multiple operating systems, let's say multiple desktops. And it will physically, it will have only one Ethernet port, but actually you will be assigning multiple IPs to that. So you need a virtual network for it. And so these both compute cloud and storage clouds enables your cloud infrastructures. And with the cloud infrastructure, you can able to build your cloud platforms for specific technology. With cloud platforms, you can able to build cloud application and you can able to deploy it. So these three are the pillars of the cloud computing, the recent one. And let's look at the players. So who are all the parties which are involved in this cloud computing era? So the base is you need a hardware. So to build up any kind of a cloud infrastructure, you need a hardware. So the hardware is really typically the computer, and you need a disk to store your data, and you need a switch to connect all these things, and it has to be accessed outside. So believe me, with these computers, we can able to make a cloud. So you have different computers, you can able to see the hard disk, you can able to see the switch or routers. So even with a number of computers, any arbitrary hardware, you can able to make a cloud order. So what else? So I have all the hardware, so what else I need? So the very important thing is that you need the technology vendors. You need the software to make sure that it pulls everything and it will give you the computational power. So for servers, so these are the solutions of VMware and Citrix. For network, Cisco and storage, so EMC and NetApp are the major providers for the storage. So you have to buy the solution from all these three people. You have to orchestrate everything and you have to build a cloud out of it. And next, what we need? So we have the cloud infrastructure, so we need resellers, we need the providers. So you need to find out the salespeople or the sales companies, so they will give all these kind of, so they will reach the end users and they will get a subscribers for you. And finally, the users, so people, so they will get the customers, so customers, users will use our cloud technologies. And so let's look at the service model. So we already have out, so X as a service, so it could be anything as a service. And so these are the major one, infrastructure and your platform and software. And so this is evolving, your network as a service, storage and desktop. And yeah, so there is a lot more, security, data, your database, communication, and much more. So that's why they call anything as a service. So let's talk about the first one, infrastructure as a service. So it is also called the cloud infrastructure. And typically, it's approximately what it is, you will get a hardware for rent. You will get a remote hardware for rent. So what are the hardware that you can get? So you will get a server, storage, for disk, and network. And typically, if you get a infrastructure, so you are the king. So you get to manage everything. So you need to, you can install your own OS, you can install all your things. So you need to maintain everything. And so you have a complete control on this environment. And so nobody has a limited set here. So you can do whatever you want in this infrastructure. Typically, so these are all the infrastructure providers. And so I'm sorry, I'm going first. I have only very little time. So let's go for the platform. It's called a cloud platforms. Typically, it will be developer friendly. It will have a lot of tools for, deploy your applications, to run your application. You manage, you can upgrade everything. So there are a number of tools for it. And typically, you will be a kind of a minister role where, all your OS upgrade and everything can be handled by your platform vendor. So you don't have any control it. So what you have is you have a container and closed environment where you can just use the tools, you can deploy your apps. So again, the problem is that if let's say they will provide a set of libraries if you want to use any kind of an external library, so you have a problem here. Some vendors will support it, some vendors will say, no, you have to use only my library. And again, so you have a zero control over the infrastructure and environment, and you have a limited control over your platforms. And so these are the typical major vendors for platform. And software as a service, typically it's called cloud applications. So this is, people will use platform and infrastructures, and they have built the application. You can just subscribe and you can use it. Either you can use your, you can use it for your personal app, or you can use it for business apps. And typically it will come up with a, you know, free model or paid model. Free in terms of, you know, non-commercial use, paid will be the commercial or enterprise apps. And there is something called freemium model. So you will get a limited set of functionality, or you can have a limited set of volumes for free. So if you go beyond that, you need to pay it. And yeah, again, you are a citizen and everything is managed and provided by someone else. You don't have any control of anything. So what you have is, you are using an application, you have a user preference page. That's all you have. You don't have anything else for your control. So these are the major vendors. So there is a lot of lists. So these are the major vendors which provides this kind of a cloud applications. And there is something else coming up that's called desktop as a service. So that's also called virtual desktop infrastructure. And it's something like, I am a developer for some XYZ company, and let's say I don't need to get a typical laptop or a desktop which has n number of developer tools and everything involved. So they have this infrastructure, they will get installed everything, including the license. What you have is, you need to use your own device. So this is called bring your own device. You can use your laptop or thin client. Just you have to use your security token, you can be able to get access to it. And typically they have a client for all the mobile operating systems, so now you can use it in your mobile as well. So these are major providers. Let's talk about the storage. So if you talk about the cloud, let's say you have an application and you have a storage, and your application goes for your application is down for some time, means again you can restart the server, you can bring your servers up. There is no loss in it, just a few minutes of time, some downtime. Let's talk about the storage. What happens if your data loss happens? You cannot recover it. So storage is very important, and so storage as a service is catching up. So someone is giving the complete session about storage as a service in the afternoon. And typically we'll be using a storage for serving your primary data or backup. And let's say there are a lot of compliance, so you have to archive your data. And nowadays there is for your legal proof, so paper is not required. So you can have to have all your mail communication electronically. So you have to use the archiving. And typically, so you can use this, storage service for your disaster recovery. And so these are the major providers. So it starts from Amazon to Google, HPE, Microsoft, and I just put this chart to understand who are the providers. And let's talk about the availability of the cloud service. Typically, if you talk about availability, means it's high availability. How long it will be available for us? Typically, if some cloud provider says, my application will be available for 99%. So that's fine. 99% seems to be enough, right? So it's something like approximately 100. But it is actually not. So this is statistics. So someone will say 99%, someone will say 99.9, and 99.49, 99.569. So there is a difference in it. Let's talk about 1 year, and let's talk about the downtime. And if it is 99%, means you will have 88 hours downtime. That means it's more than 3 days. More than 3 days, your application will be down. So this is for 39, 49, 59. You can see the difference. If someone says 99.9 and someone says 99.99, this is the difference. So you have to make sure that if you're picking your cloud provider, so you have to ask your availability timing or SLA or whatever it is. And typically the industry wanted to achieve is something like 5 nines. So you will have just 5 minutes downtime for the entire year. So it could be your patch upgrade or it could be anything else. So let's go for a simple use case. Let's take a Yago. And what happens if Yago is down for 5 minutes? With 5, 9 SLAs. Okay. So typically, let's say all the services are shut down. So the typical thing is that it will make into all the newspaper headlines. So all the internet, so they will say Yago is down. And think about something else. Delta Airlines. So they are the number one, the biggest airlines in the world. And they carry 2.5 lakhs people per day or per instance. If the flights are not able to access their cloud providers, so you can see the risk of the people. So 2.5 people are under risk. But in terms of Yago, it's zero. Even this 5-9 is okay for Yago, since there is no life risk involved, but that is not okay for this kind of a mission critical real-time applications. So again, you have to choose between what kind of an application you want to deploy. Okay, so let's talk about Google. Again, what happens if Google is down for 5 minutes? Again, same case as Yahoo, no live city. But they will lose half $1 million for 5 minutes. It's something like if you convert in Indian rupees, 2.5 crores. That's okay, it's a peanut for them. But what they lose, it's a brand value. What happens if complete Google is shut down for 5 minutes? Again, it's a news and everyone will be talking about it. So again, this is important when you choose your cloud providers. And let's say if someone says 90%, I will be giving 90% availability. If you ask me, I'll be okay if they provide 0% data corruptions. Again, let's talk about a simple example. So what happens if your Gmail is down for maybe 1 hour in every quarter? I'm okay with that. What happens if your complete Gmail data is corrupted? Let's say it is not able to recover it. So which one is better? So downtime is better. So you have to make sure that you don't have, you have a 100% data protection and 0% data corruption. So typically, if you see the recovery, if something goes wrong, it will take 3 times than backup time. So it is a large amount of time. So this also you have to take care of it. And again, storage is very crucial in the cloud. So people will be ignoring the storage part. So this is very important. And let's go for the cost factor. So there is something called capital expenditure. So this is involves you purchase everything. So you'll purchase your all kind of hardware. So that's initial investment. It's called capital expenditures. And that's called OPEX. OPEX is operational things. So you wanted to maintain all your servers, right? So your power and other kind of a staff and everything is called OPEX. And there is something called setup cost. Typically, if you see the cloud, so it will be involved only OPEX and setup cost. So there is no capital expenditures involved here. And let's look at the few deployment models. Typically, we know the private clouds, right? So you build everything on your own. You will buy all the hardware. So you will have a capital expenditure. So you will have operational expenditures. And it is called internal or on-premises. The only difference between typical application is that, let's say my first employer has a 500 application, in-house applications, all are distributed. So they have individual servers for individual applications. So what they can do is they can pool everything. And let's say they need only the hardware for just 200 applications. So they can, maybe some 50 to 60% requirement, they can able to reduce it. And public cloud, it's very same. And it is actually maintained by the third party or external one. And it's off-premise. And there is something called virtual private cloud. So what you will use, public cloud to build your private cloud. Let's say in the public cloud, I want this kind of a dedicated servers only to deploy my applications. Only I can able to, only from these IP ranges, I can able to access that particular node. So you can have this virtual private cloud also. There is something called cloud computing. It's something like a private cloud. Let's say me and my partners doing a business with me. So we buy the hardware and we will put all our applications over there. So that's called community cloud. And there is something called hybrid cloud. So this is the major one which is adaptable for all the major organizations. So they will use both public and private cloud. So they will use private cloud for all the computational problems and they will use storage, private cloud for storing all the things. The only thing is that if you put your data on your public, so you have a risk over there. So typically if you see all your application server, web servers will be there in the public cloud. All your databases, message queues, and user contacts, all the sensitive data will be remains in your private cloud. So this is a major model which is adopted in most of the big corporates. And let's go for the tenancy. So in the cloud, there is something called single tenancy. So customer, your cloud provider will give you the dedicated stack for you. And you have the all this control over on your per customer. So if you are a single customer, you can have any kind of these kind of configurations for you. Let's go for a multi-tenancy. Again, so they have a single kind of a setup and a lot of customers will be served in it. So you don't have any kind of a individual specific configuration. So one action for all kind of a customer. If they wanted to go for upgrade, if they go over a downtime, it is going to be affected by all the users. So typically, I use a picture to understand, if you are not understand the multi-tenancy. So this is it. So one infrastructure, and you can see a number of people using it. So the balancing act. So we have a different kind of an applications. Let's say we have something called weekday application. Typically, all the business applications will be served in the, they have a peak load on the weekdays. And other kind of a fancy kind of applications, let's say retail and other kinds, will have a load on weekends. So you have to balance it in such a way that in weekdays, the same server will be utilized for your business applications, and weekends, the same server will be utilized for all your retail applications. And let's look at the adoption. So we have a different kind of enterprises, starts from small to medium to the big corporates. So the small companies will put most of the things over there, and mid-size, they will put many things, not all, and large companies will put very small things. So they will make sure that they will have this public and private things. They will put all the computational to the, you know, public cloud. And let's talk about the security. So this is what happens if you put your data on the cloud, public cloud. Anyone can able to look at the data, no matter what they say. And there is a technical possibility is that. So this is the agreement, license agreement, or the privacy policy of a Dropbox. You can see the data. They said employees are not able to access the data. Typically, so they have the data center, they have everything access. Typically, they can able to access this. There's a lot of controversy in it. Finally, what they have changed it. Employees are prohibited from viewing. So that means they agreed that employee can have an access, but they have prohibited from or accessing or viewing the data. So this is the major impact which happened in the Dropbox. So you have to make sure that you have to read all your licenses. And in the Dropbox case, so this is technically possible. If you put the data, any almighty who has a super user access can able to see your data. And so again, putting the data in the cloud is a main problem. So how do you build a trust? If you go to this particular URL, so Amazon Web Services, they will have, we have this kind of standards, we acquired this kind of certificates, we follow this kind of a compliance. So there are a lot of bodies are building up, so they want to provide, make sure that the user trusts putting the data on the cloud. And so what happens to the mega upload? And what happens if you are not comply with particular standard? Let's say if I have put all my data on my mega upload, so US federal government seized it, so all my data is gone. You have to make sure that your cloud storage provider or service provider will follow all the compliances, or immediately you will lose all your data. And again, we know the Netflix things which has happened right on the Christmas Eve. So they run on the Amazon infrastructure, and everything is went down. You know what Amazon replied? It's a human error and everything is went down. So again, so you should have a disaster recovery plan. You have to ask all for it. And again, so cloud to cloud communication is not much interoperable. So there is a open cloud consortium, so which is building some standards for it. It's still evolving. And again, we have a compliance problems. So again, the compliance will be depends upon, you'll have a cloud application can be served in anywhere in the world, but you have to comply with the individual country or state wise. Typically, you have to follow all the local laws. You know the local laws of India? So India requested all the Skype, BlackBerry, and Google to put local servers for all the VoIP kind of calling. They want to implement all your data. Again, you cannot put data center for all the 200 countries, right? So that's also a problem. So these are quick facts. So it's a $4 billion market in 2012. This cloud, 1997 itself, is talking about putting all your data on iCloud. There is a nice YouTube video. I have put it on the reference. You can watch it. And 90% of R&D budget, Microsoft put it on, in 2001, Microsoft put it for this cloud research. And again, so Dell try to, trademark this cloud computing so no one can able to use it, but it has been rejected now. So these are the major wonders. So you can just, all this, you might have heard about all these things, you can go on, you can check it. And yeah, so last time I am done. Questions? Probably I will take it after Sashi's session. Thanks.
Good morning, all. My name is Sasi. I'm just working as a virtualization admin. Let me tell you what's happened behind the scene when we talk about cloud. Or typically whenever you request for a server for or instance for your developing an application, what's happened back end? Enterprise IT, I'm going to talk about enterprise IT because, we handle more enterprise, customers. So, it has seven layers. The first one is a data center. Whenever you talk about data center, it has security, the storage or, rack or, the overall, the infrastructure. And the next networking layer. So you need to take care of networking. So if you don't have networking layer correctly set up, again, it's gonna mess up. So the third one, the device layer, what are the device and what kind of device you are gonna put it on the data center. And the operating system layer, what kind of operating system you are gonna use it. The next one, application infrastructure, and what are all the infrastructure you need to develop your application to or to manage your business. And the next one, the application layer, and what are the IT department, and which department is going to handle what application. Then at last, business process. So what are the process you need to make sure to accomplish all the stuffs? Let's talk about a developer. So let's name it as Shiva. He's a super duper developer. And, you know, he got a requirement from customer to, you know, to develop an application. He needed infrastructure for that. So what he will do? So he just, you know, generate specification. And, you know, he just request manager that, now I need that infrastructure. Then, you know, the manager send it to architect, you know, for each and every infrastructure, there will be an architect behind that. So they need to approve and they should go ahead to deploy that. Then, you know, manager approaches, once the architect approves, then it goes to business finance. So now they need to get approval from business finance to host your servers or on data center or on on-premises. Then, you know, then what happened next? So, you know, this is a very crucial part. The manager has to, you know, break his head to get it approved from business finance. You know, though they have money, you know, they have limited resources. They need to plan, and you know, most of the scenarios, if they have, you know, if you're looking for example, $1,000, you know, they'll allocate you $800, saying that no, we have some kind of limitations. You need to go with this, and you need to change your infrastructure according to that. And you know, the once it's done, you know, it comes to sysadmin part as what we manage, like, you know, scope of work, what are the work needs to be done to create their infrastructure. Then next, you know, that request, you know, it will come to us. And you know, we build the server and what are the checklists and all there. And you know, what are based on the requirements, we install the software on it. And you know, we hand over it to you. So now you test and give it, say, okay, it's okay. Then we add those things into inventory and change it to production. So it's, you know, it's up to you. So, but you know, this process will take long time. So, okay. So that's the reason, cloud. What will happen in cloud? So you're gonna raise a request. Everything is managed through a portal and manager approves. Then automatically it goes to architect next level. Then, you know, it goes to IT department. Based on the once every approval is in place, based on the script, your server gonna build automatically within minutes. So you no need to worry. And you know, it will come to you directly. So you know, the, all this process, it will happen in minutes. It depends upon your the managers and architect approval time. So rather, you know, if you go for a you know, individual thing, it's really gonna take much time. So I'm gonna talk about one of our customer, what we have handled. So the customer have their terminals. They have the application access through iPad, and they have access, no application access through mobile phones. It's an, you know, online reservation system. So, you know, they used Citrix technology, ZenApp and ZenDesktop, to provide those applications remotely. And, you know, they, you know, often expand their branches, so they use this technology. And again, you know, they face a lot of challenges, and, you know, the users are getting increased very frequently. And setup cost, whenever they, you know, bring up a new, you know, branches, you know, they need to spend much time on that. And though they have, you know, enough infrastructure, those resources are not utilized fully. You know, say for example, underutilized, below 50% of those server resources. And you know, since it's a reservation system, during festival times, you know, they faced many issues with, you know, overload and capacity issues. So what was decided? Okay, so what the solution it was provided? So the servers, you know, we built it with this private cloud and with Citrix technology on top of that. So you know, users are able to access, and you know, they can able to scale up, you know, with the same resources what they have it already. So you know, so as a result, the customer got very happy. Then another one, you know, they can scale their servers on demand whenever there is a need. Say for example, during Thanksgiving day time or Christmas time or you know any other vacation or festival times. So again, they were able to you know completely utilize their infrastructure up to 60 to 70% as a benchmark, and you know they could able to you know save money also. Typically, whenever you manage a server and data center, every month they have to pay $500 an average. It depends on the vendor and the technology in average. But you know, if you go with Amazon Cloud, you know, stuff, so you have to pay $350. So again, you know, you have a cost reduction and the time savings. So you know, that's what my case study. Thank you. I think you know, if you have any questions, you know, we are happy to help you.
Just an introduction session, so there are another 4 to 5 sessions specifically for
as a service, and how to design your disaster recovery so you can avoid this kind of netlist kind of an outage, and how to scale your application with cloud. There are other sessions, so I'm not sure about the schedule. You can check the schedule and do check it out. Thank you very much. So it has been a great day.